from our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Today is All Saints' Day, one of the oldest festivals in the Christian calendar. And it is a day when we remember those that have departed from this world in faith. And we also remember those that have been an example to us in their Christian living. On All Saints' Day, the word saint may bring questions to our mind. What is a saint? And how good do you have to be a saint? And will I ever be a saint? That's a good question. I'd like to give you an exercise for a moment. Imagine over here in this corner by this door were the worst sinners. And then over here in this corner, by this door, are the most holy of saints. And along this line, there are those of the rest of us standing. And just for a moment, imagine that you are standing. And how good are you in your own thinking? If we were to compare ourselves to those extreme sinners, we would probably rank the worst of those mass murderers. And in the corner there, they would be quite extreme, and we would definitely be better than them. Well, what about a little bit farther, closer? There was the murderer who, in rage, killed somebody. We wouldn't even get close to that extreme. Or what about the man who took another man's wife? Possibly it could get even closer to us. But what about in this line of sinners? What happens if we got as close as one who had betrayed his best friend? Maybe then that would possibly get close to home. But if we are probably honest with ourselves, we would then say, that's on that side of the line. Those are extreme sinners, and I really don't get close to them. But what about on the other side? The most holy of men and women, the Mother Teresa's of the world, would we compare our goodness to them? Would we line up close to them? Let's just not even include Mother Teresa. Let us include the true saints from the Bible. Would we be close to St. Paul, who gave his life up for the church and wrote half of the New Testament? Or would we get close to Peter as well, too? Peter, who hung upside down on a cross because he didn't feel that he was worthy to die like Jesus. Or maybe if we were to look at the Old Testament saints, the patriarchs, the heroes of the Old Testament, would we be close to David, a man described in the scriptures as one followed his heart, was well connected with God, a man after God's own heart, the scripture declares. Or would we be like Moses, who led the children of Israel? Now, the question of how good and how sinful you are would be kind of difficult. You may say, I'm not like that extreme sinner, and I'm not like that extreme saint. I'm just an ordinary person. By now, you probably realize that the extreme sinners that I've identified, and the extreme saints that I've also identified, are both one and the same. You may remember from your stories of Sunday school and reading the Bible that Peter, the great saint of God, was a mass murderer. He oversaw the killing of Christians, and one of his most famous was Stephen. You may then also remember that Moses as well, too. Saul, enraged by the Egyptian beating an Israelite, he killed him in cold blood, or killed him and tried to cover it up. Or maybe you remember David as well, too. A man after God's own heart, but in his heart he wanted another man's wife. Or even Peter, who our Lord trusted and called a good friend, finally turned his back on the Lord. You see, that is the wonderful thing about Scripture in which we see. The wonderful thing in which we see in Scripture is that saints are not people who have achieved some super morality over sin. And it is not some super person that has performed great acts of faith. No, saints are sinners who have experienced the grace of God. And in Christ Jesus, they are forgiven of their sins. Just listen to Paul's own biography. He says these words, "I was a blasphemer, a persecutor, a violent man, but I received mercy because I had acted ignorant and in unbelief. And in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ overflowed for me. And with faith, the love that ye are in Christ Jesus, the same is trustworthy and deserving full acceptance, that Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost." Do you hear Paul's words as he speaks about the grace of our Lord overflowing for him? It turns him from a sinner and into a saint. In our worship today, we as well saw the same thing. We saw God's grace in water and word overflow literally Jordan's sins. The pronouncement that you are a child of God, and in baptism you die to sin and you rise to newness of life. That same grace we hear in our 1 John text. "See what the Father, the love the Father has given to us, that we should be called the children of God." I like how the NIV puts it. "How great the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God." That wording of overflow and lavished draws a picture for us of God washing us in his grace and removing all of the sin that we have. It's not a picture of just a few drops of water. It's not a feeble shower of a few drops from heaven, but it is a multitude of shower heads, of gallons and barrels and rivers of God's grace flowing and overwhelming our sin and washing it all away. It's the same image that John uses in our Revelation text. Just listen to what John says. Then he said, "Who are these, sir, in white robes?" "You know," he said, "these are they who have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." The picture of Revelation as well, too, picks up that picture of God's overflow and lavishing, of that forgiving water of forgiveness that is bestowed upon us because of what Christ has done for us. It gushes. And with those same words, John gives us a picture of Christ's bride, the church, arrayed in white before his throne, worshiping him day and night and saying, "Praise be to our God forever and ever." That's the picture of All Saints' Day. Our liturgy picks that picture up as well, too. We laud and magnify the whole company of heaven. You see, it's not just us, but it's also them on the other side as well too that stand before the altar of God and worship the Lamb who was slain. This is why on All Saints' Day we do not look at the living and the dead as separate things, but we look at them as one body of Christ together worshiping. We are militant and still in the struggle with sin and this world. They are triumphant, and we in our death will join them, and we will be united with God in praise of our Lamb. Again, all of these texts and all of these scriptures remind us of God's grace which washes, which overflows, and which lavishes us sinners and makes us saints. You see, it's not in what you do, but it's in what God has done for you in Christ Jesus that makes you a saint. Luther had this struggle in his life. You may remember that before he came to the gospel, he wanted to find a gracious God, but all he was taught and all he learned was that God was a wretched judge who would carry out punishment for every little sin in which he did not confess. Luther had this matrix taught to him. that one needed to go to saints. And so Luther struggled in trying to find a graciousness of God, and so he prayed to saints. He performed acts towards saints. He prayed to relics and looked for God's forgiveness in these things. In one event, he went to Rome, and there he was told, climb these 30 steps, and on every step say a Hail Mary, and your sins will be forgiven. And all around him, he states, were other people climbing as well too. You see, although Luther lived 500 years ago, I still find that struggle within Christians as they look to God for forgiveness by what they have done. A man, Tony, in my last congregation, was coming close to death, diagnosed with an incurable illness. I got to spend time with him. And on one visit, I asked, Tony, are you ready to go to heaven? And he responded by saying, I hope I'm good enough to get into heaven. I haven't lived that bad of a life, but I've lived a good life. Tony, I found, shared Luther's struggle, that he looked for God's forgiveness in what he had done. You may feel that struggle as well, too. Living with your sin and dealing with it day in and day out, you wonder, does God forgive a person like me? In my first congregation, around this time, there was a woman who always came to us. Earlier in her college years, she put an end to a pregnancy, and yet she still felt the guilt that she was not worthy of God's love. She struggled to understand, does God love her? You see, it's not what you do, but whose you are. Just listen to how Paul puts it in this way, and you will understand. Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive in Christ even when we were dead in trespasses. For it is by grace that you have been saved. For God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show his incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in kindness toward us. For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not for yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one may boast. You see, to speak of grace is to speak of the acceptance, God's acceptance of you. Even in the midst of sin, God accepts you in Christ Jesus and lavishes his love upon you. Simply accept that you are a saint. You see, Luther read his Bible and found a different God. He learned from Romans that Jesus wasn't a judge to set everything right, but he was the one who was right and the one who made things right. Now let's return to that line of where you think you are. Whether you're toward the extreme sinner or toward the extreme saint, don't think of that, of yourself in that way. Instead, think of Christ who stands on the line, who in his righteousness gives to you all his righteousness and bears the extremes of your sin. And in doing so, you are declared righteous and you are declared a saint. May you live out your saintliness in your life. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.